aiding each other like good comrades to the utmost of their strength. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Welcome one, welcome all, welcome to another exciting episode of Training Tuesdays here on Tales of Heroes. Today is all about the British Empire, the Commonwealth, and hell, why not, the Canadians. We are talking about the British faction today. We're giving you a general overview, what they can do, how their veterancy works, what makes them special, what you can expect to get out of their each individual units. So without further ado, let me introduce myself. I am Bridger, a.k.a. Adam Ruzzo. And with me, as always, is my talented co-host, Rogers. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Bridger. I'm really looking forward to show everyone this overview of the British faction, seeing as I'd imagine the community grew quite heavily with all the Steam sales that were recently underway for summer. So I think a lot of people probably picked up this game, and they probably have a lot of questions about the different factions, so we're here to answer them.
All right. So yes, we're going to try to do sort of a more newbie-friendly show, and then the next Training Tuesday is going to be a more in-depth look at a specific unit like we did last week with the Rifleman. So this will be the very general overview of the British for newer players, and then next week we're going to jump, or, well, 2 weeks from now, we're going to jump into another in-depth look at a specific unit. So without further ado, after the ado that we already had, let's jump right into it and take a look at command trucks. One of the unique aspects of the British faction is that they get, instead of base buildings and building bases back here in the HQ area, you get trucks, specifically three different command trucks. You start with the headquarters command truck. This one allows you to build your basic infantry section, your lieutenant, which allows you to gain veterancy and also buffs nearby infantry, as well as the Bren carrier, which acts as a fast mobile platform as well as a machine gun when you upgrade it. It can also do armor piercing. Then, after you've gotten enough fuel, you can call in the field support truck. That requires a lieutenant to be on the field, so you can't go straight to it. You need to spend a little bit of fuel on the lieutenant. Once you get there, then you can build sappers and a Stuart light tank. And then you also are able to build a captain who gives you defensive bonuses to your emplacements and infantry. Once you've built a captain, then you can call in the armor support truck. And the armor support truck gives you access to the Cromwell tank, the Cromwell command tank, and the Sherman Firefly. And the Cromwell command tank is requirement to build the Sherman Firefly, which is excessively deadly against enemy tanks. So another important thing about these trucks is, you know, you can pack them up and send them wherever you want to go, but ideally you want to get them, you know, put them down in the right place the first time. And the right place is often right on top of whatever resource you need, because not only do they act as an OP in the form that they prevent the opponent from capturing or decapturing that point once you get the truck set up there, they also give you increased resources. So when your truck sets up on that point, it's as if you placed an observation post with the Wehrmacht or the American players, where you get extra resources on it. So this plus 16 here is plus 16 right now, but as soon as the truck sets up, it's going to be plus 26 fuel. And then this plus 16 over here, when this truck sets up, is going to be plus 26 munitions. So it's a very, very, very powerful ability to lock down a sector and get extra resources from it. The downside is your buildings and your base is now much more exposed. It's out on the field. It's not protected by these Vickers machine guns anymore, and so it's vulnerable. You have to be careful about that, as we saw in Tales of Heroes number 77 recently. Your base is very vulnerable to grenadier rushes. So, that is those in brief. Let's move on to talk about how British veterancy works and what's the deal with all of these officers.
Okay, guys, so now we're going to talk about British veterancy. They gain veterancy different from any other faction. Basically, their individual units do not gain veterancy. The officers gain the veterancy for the unit, and then they transfer the buffs back to the unit. It works similar to the Cromwell Command Tank, which we will be discussing later. Bridger, do you want to get into the officer, the lieutenant?
All right, let's talk about the lieutenant first. He gives offensive-style veterancy to the units that are nearby. You can see this little star above my infantry. That indicates that the lieutenant is in range of them. These infantry over here do not have a star, so they do not have the lieutenant in range. So we can see the difference in this little set up fight here. The infantry in the north have the officer, and they're getting the following bonuses. They move faster in enemy territory, and they have accuracy and damage bonuses. So in the north here, they're already down to two units, and in the south, they're also down to two units, but it looks like the north is going a little fast. Now it's down to one unit, and the north is going to be killed first, because this officer is generating some bonuses for these units. In specifics, I believe it's like a 15% better accuracy and a 15% better damage. Now, if I move the officer down here to the middle, he can give bonuses to both of those units because he does it within a specific radius. That radius is 30 game units, which is about the range between two long-range units when they're fighting. So it's about the range from where these guys are to the edge of their line of sight. Most units have around a 30-unit line of sight. So that's how far the lieutenant's range is. He also generates, you notice, he's now got a bar of veterancy on him, because throughout that fight, as my infantry killed things, the veterancy was transferred to the officer, and now he is a little bit stronger. At veterancy level 1, he gets defensive and health bonuses for himself. In addition, Heroic Charge becomes unlocked, and that is a special ability that the lieutenant has, which, when activated, will all nearby squads, all nearby squads generate this bonus, and they get much faster, and they fire faster, and they do more damage, and they take less damage, and it breaks suppression. They can't be suppressed during this. They're just running around. Now, after the 15 seconds at which the heroic charge runs out, all units move slower and reload slower and fire slower. So there's 15 seconds of awesome superhuman strength, and then 15 seconds of, I'm so tired. So heroic charge is very useful for getting rid of a machine gun, for example. I used it way too early in this case, but normally you can charge right up and take out a machine gun. Veterancy level 2 gives additional accuracy, damage, and firing speed bonuses. And then veterancy level 3 actually gives you +4 to your population cap and a command point to spend on whatever you want. So vetting up your lieutenant is usually quite useful. Why don't you tell us about the captain, Rogers?
All right, the captain basically operates on a different type of veterancy. Basically, you have offensive and defensive veterancy. The captain is the defensive part of the British veterancy spectrum. He basically gives defensive buffs to infantry as well as emplacements and, I believe, trucks as well. So if you have a captain sitting in a trench, he's going to help create an aura around the sector that he's in that will buff all the health of the emplacements around him and any units as well. So it's very useful to have a captain in an emplacement-heavy sector or around your base. Do you want to get into the specifics of that, Bridger?
Sure. So the captain gives emplacements about 25% more health for the sector that he's in. So note that difference. The lieutenant has a range, a radius around which he gives buffs to infantry. The captain does it within a specific territory sector. You can see the white lines here representing where the captain is buffing. And then you can see on the mini-map here, the green territory shows me where my captain is. It also lowers the incoming damage and provides health regeneration for infantry in that sector. Once it gets to veterancy level 1, the captain gets a little bit of bonus health. And once it gets to veterancy level 2, the emplacements will get more health and infantry get further defensive bonuses and health regeneration. And in veterancy level 3, the captain actually acts as a further observation post, further increasing the amount of resources. So if this is a level level 3 captain, instead of 26 incoming refuel, we'd actually be getting 30 or 31 from this instead. So that's the overview of the captain. He gives the defensive bonuses. Another very important thing about the captain is you can actually retreat units to him once he is built. So I can select these units, and if I don't want to retreat all the way to the HQ, for example, I can retreat sort of sideways by clicking the retreat withdraw to captain's position button. It acts just like a regular retreat, except instead of going to the HQ, they go to the captain. So that's one way to maybe pull your guys out of combat just a tiny bit to break suppression, but then charge right back in because you didn't lose anybody. Lastly, very important, keep your officers alive. Don't lose them, they're expensive. So let's take a quick look at Heroic Charge. Heroic Charge lasts for 15 seconds and grants you defensive bonuses and offensive bonuses. So let's say you're charging in here, and oh, we got pinned by that machine gun. Well, officer hits Heroic Charge, they're no longer pinned, they can move faster, and they're going to fire faster. So we get around and flank the machine gun, and for 15 seconds we get all these benefits and bonuses. But as soon as those 15 seconds are over, you'll notice that there will be a red glow. There it is. What that means is they are now in fatigue mode after the heroic charge. They now get penalties in those same categories. So they're going to fire slower and they're going to move slower. But the assault was still successful, and that's what's important. So that heroic charge gives you the 15 seconds of no suppression, faster firing, and taking less damage. And then following that, you get 15 seconds of slower movement and slower firing. So that's a pretty useful ability, and the lieutenant gets it at veterancy level 1.
So guys, let's talk about the main British infantry. The main British infantry consists of the infantry sections, which are very costly, and they have soldier armor, which makes them stronger than regular infantry. They move slow in uncapped territory without their lieutenant. But once they have their lieutenant, then they move at normal range in any territory. Their best use is at medium and long range, and they can build emplacements. Bridger, do you want to get into the specifics?
So the infantry section can have three different upgrades. The recon upgrade, the Bren light machine gun upgrade, and the rifle grenade upgrade, and these are exclusive. So once we build one of them, you can't get the other two for the same unit. So what I've got right here, I've got a recon, I've got a Bren, and I've got a rifle grenade. Let's take a closer look at the recon section. Now the recon section is what you start out with when you play as the British. You start out with one recon section. Recon sections are weaker than normal units, but they have a vastly superior line of sight. Notice how far this recon section can see. It's extremely far. It's actually longer than the machine gun's line of sight, so I could actually sneak up on a machine gun, see it, and flank it without it ever seeing me. So the line of sight on these guys is huge. They also have a pretty decent detection radius when they're trying to hunt for snipers. They also have a special ability called Deploy Marksman. For 25 munitions, they can snipe an enemy. So if we see that sniper, we're going to get closer to him and then find him and deploy a sniper so he can't get us. But this is problematic because it's important to know that this Deploy Marksman range is much lower than the standard sniper range. So if he has a sniper in the back of a battle, and I'm trying to charge forward to kill it, he could just kite me with his sniper. So you gotta be very careful. And one way of getting around that is to put your marksman squad in a Bren carrier. Use that to chase down the sniper, then quickly get out and snipe him with the marksman. At the very least, you'll force him to retreat. So that covers it, almost everything, except for the fact that recon sections also move faster than normal sections when in enemy territory. We talked earlier how the infantry section moves slower when not in friendly territory, but recon sections can move at full speed no matter where they are. They don't need to be accompanied by a lieutenant. This makes them very good capping and harassing units. Lastly, they cannot build trenches, sadly enough, and we'll talk more about those in the emplacements section of the show. Alright, let's talk about the Bren upgrade. This gives light machine guns to two of the squad members here, and it also gives the button ability, which we will demonstrate right here. You want to use it at as close range as possible. It will basically freeze the enemy vehicle. That vehicle cannot shoot or move for the next 40 seconds or so. 20 seconds. So, as you can see, the Brens also do a lot of damage to the vehicle. They basically act kind of like bars in that respect. Unlike bars, the Brens cannot be fired on the move. So if we start moving, that vehicle is no longer buttoned. And that's very important to know, because if you're trying to chase down enemies with Brens, you're going to be at a disadvantage. Or if you're trying to run away and fight, so you must make sure if you want to shoot at something with Brens, you have to stop and target, and then the Brens will fire and blow it up. Now, the Brens also just give generally more infantry firepower to your unit. So in a lot of ways, they're very similar to bars. Just instead of suppression fire, they have this button ability. The third upgrade that is available to the infantry section is the rifle grenade, as you can see positioned here. It is launched from two of the different riflemen that you have here, and it has a very long range, but is fairly inaccurate. So it can do a decent amount of splash damage to units either on the field, but also in buildings. It does decent damage to units in buildings. And it's wise to use its indirect fire capabilities in this situation, for example, to attack the units in that house by just giving them orders to stay here, and then these units will use their long range to fire their rifle grenades at the building. Now, this isn't fast, although, see there, it did a big chunk of damage. You can see they shoot every 4 to 6 seconds or so, and they miss a lot, but it will force your opponent to retreat or try and come take care of you. All right, the last interesting feature that the rifle grenade squad has is it has the ability to lay down smoke. So I'm going to click on that right now, and we'll see how the smoke works. Well, there it is. Now, the MG42 can't hit us, but the rifle grenade accuracy is not really affected by the smoke. It's still laying down the smoke in the same area, and unlike many other smoke grenades, these smoke grenades kill things.
All right, guys, now we are going to talk about sappers. Sappers are the basic repair unit, and they basically operate similar to pioneers or the American engineer. They can lay mines, they can cut barbed wire, and they can also build different emplacements, more powerful emplacements, than infantry sections have access to. Bridger, would you like to get into the specifics of it?
So sappers can be upgraded in three different ways. They can get a Piat upgrade, which is essentially an anti-tank weapon similar to, but not exactly like, a bazooka or a Panzerschreck. A disposal and detection section, which allows them to specialize in mine detection as well as demo charges, just like the engineers on the American side. And lastly, expert engineers, which allows them to repair faster and to over-repair units. So first, let's take a look at the Piats. Piats have two members of their squads with these special anti-tank bazooka-type weapons that are especially good at killing units which are standing still. The other cool upgrade you get when you get Piats is this camouflage, this Piat ambush. Assuming you're in cover like these guys are, you can click this button and they are now camouflaged. So go ahead and bring a tank forward. They launch two Piats there and they're still camouflaged. The tank still can't see them. And now they just appeared for the second volley. Now, bam, just like that, Piat ambush, goodbye tank. Piats can be extremely powerful if firing at stationary targets. So when you're fighting against Piats, if you can, keep your tank moving. All right, so what do you do if your opponent does not stand still? Well, that's exactly what a button is for. You bring forward your Bren squad, you button it, and now Piats can fire with impunity and take it out. Goodbye. All right. So the disposal and destruction section here is your mine detector. It's like the upgrade when you want your engineers or your pioneers to be able to detect mines, because that douchebag that's near you is screwing up with your game by planting mines, and you hate him. So the other thing that they can do is plant these demo charges on buildings. So if I come over here and the officer goes, "Oh no, I'll just hide in the building."
Get out of here.
Oh, well, screw you.
Destroyed a German target.
So that's how the demo charges can be used to kill a single officer. It's satisfying if not effective. So now let's take a look at the special expert repairing sappers. Right here you can see that this Stuart, and why don't you come on in and attack here. This Stuart has a white health bar. That means that it is over-repaired. And unlike this Stuart in the north, it has a bunch of extra health. So it can take more damage. All right, so another thing that over-repair does, or blah, 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 blah. Another thing that expert engineers do really well is repair. For example, let's try repairing both of these and comparing the repair rates. As you can see, the guy on the right here was started at a lower health level, but because it's being repaired by expert engineers, they are going to repair it faster, and it's actually going to complete before the guy on the left. They repair at 10 HP per second, unlike the guys on the left that are only repairing at 5 HP per second. So once we get to the top of the row here, suddenly the bar turns white and it's getting healed further, extra healing, which means when it goes into battle the next time it'll take a bit more damage to kill it. Alright, next we're going to talk about the vehicles that are available to the British. We see them lined up right here. You've got your Bren carrier, which is available right at the beginning of the game, the Stuart, which is available once you get to the second command truck, and then the last three all come from the armor command truck. We're going to take a look at them, but in general, the British tanks are weaker against armor than pretty much all of the other factions' tanks, except maybe the PE. The Sherman is the only really solid tank killer that the British have, but even it will not stand up toe-to-toe with another tank in the same way that the Sherman for the Americans can actually stand toe-to-toe with a Panzer IV. The Firefly really needs to stay far away from the action and snipe from long distance. So let's take a look at each of these guys in detail. All right, the Bren carrier. The Bren carrier is your beginning, is one of the units you can build right at the beginning. Costs a little bit of fuel, but it might be worth it because it can move around the map very quickly. And you can put your infantry sections inside it, and they can shoot out while they are inside it. Now, the problem with the Bren carrier is it doesn't have a whole lot of health, and it is kind of a light vehicle, so it takes a little bit of damage from enemy light arms. In addition, once an enemy gets Panzer Shreks or even Panzer Fausts that they can use, the Bren becomes very fragile and very easy to kill, and you have to be very careful with it to keep it alive. But in the early game, especially if you upgrade it with its medium machine gun, it can be very useful in taking down enemy infantry and light vehicles because it gains the armor-piercing ability.
So next up, guys, is the Stuart Light Tank, which comes out of the field support truck. And it's very effective against infantry units. It's very quick and agile. It's a good little tank. It's poor against tanks. It can't stand up toe-to-toe with a Panzer IV or Stugger or anything like that, unless very, very well microed. One very useful ability that also makes this a total infantry shredder is the canister shot ability. This thing will shred blobs to pieces. If you have a few squads coming at you, pop that ability. It's going to cut them up real good.
All right, the Cromwell is the sort of main battle tank that the British get here, and it is fairly comparable to the Sherman or the Panzer IV, but it just has lower penetration against enemy tanks compared to those two. You really have to be able to flank with the Cromwell in order to do decent damage against an enemy tank that is medium or larger. Luckily, it has this really cool flank speed button that lets it move extremely quickly and just take off and zoom around enemy armor. So the flank speed is going to be used not only to crush enemy infantry, because I know that's what everybody uses it for, but it also can be used to race behind enemy armor and hit them in the rear. Combine that with button to prevent the enemy from spinning around, and the Cromwell actually turns into a pretty decent tank killer, at least of the medium level tanks, like a Panzer IV.
Next, guys, we have the Cromwell Command Tank, which is basically the officer of the British vehicles. It acts in much the same way. It basically, any nearby vehicles inside the radius of the command tank will contribute to the veterancy, which in turn will give the buffs back to the vehicles that the command tank is around. Vet 0, which is the default veterancy that it starts at, it basically grants faster reloads, a longer range, longer sight for friendly tanks, which is also very useful, so it'll help you get that range advantage or the first strike against enemy vehicles if the command tank is near. Veterancy level 2, units fire even faster, the reloads are faster as well, longer range, and a longer sight radius, so you can really help buff that Firefly to get a really long shot off, and the enemy has no chance of hitting it back. They'll have to close in much closer. In the meantime, you can do a lot more damage. Bridger, would you like to cover the Firefly?
Sure. It's also worth noting that the command tank has no main gun. I forgot to put that in my notes, but it does not have any main gun that is actually useful, so it just kind of sits there and absorbs experience and gives out buffs. All right, so that brings us lastly to the Firefly. The Firefly, you can tell, is based on the Sherman chassis, but it has an extremely long gun barrel on that thing. And in general, it's a very weak tank compared to most of the other tanks in the game. It has pretty low health, and it doesn't really block that many shots that are incoming on it. However, it has an extremely, extremely long range, and it's even longer with the Cromwell command tank. So the Firefly you're going to want to keep at the back of a fight, right next to the command tank, because the Firefly actually has a special bonus only applied to it that lets it fire 20% faster when the command tank is nearby, in addition to the normal command tank's 25% faster firing bonus. So the Firefly compounds that a second time and gets to be a real beast when it's near a command tank. So you got to keep it at the back and try to keep it away from enemy tanks, because it actually not only has bonuses for long range, it has penalties for short range, which is interesting. So that is the Firefly. That's your tank killer. Keep it far away from tanks. As odd as that sounds. All right, what you see in front of you are the emplacements that are built by the infantry section. We have the trench, we have the mortar, and we have the Vickers machine gun. We also have the casualty clearing station. We'll go over the ones that are specific to the sappers in just a minute. Let's start with the trench. So why don't you come on up here, Rogers? Right now, okay. I've got these guys sitting in the trench. The trench provides bonuses that are about equal to building bonuses. And you can see they're not taking much damage, even from the Panzer Shreks. However, just like in buildings, units in a trench are very vulnerable to grenades. Fire is also another great tool to kill units inside of a trench. Now, trenches are very useful for the British side, but they can be captured. And if you don't want to do that, you can delete the trench by hitting the delete button twice, and now I've managed to ensure that even though I lost the trench and I lost my guys, I didn't give the trench to my opponent for him to occupy. So remember, delete your trenches if you don't actively have anybody in them. They're very quick to build. Your infantry sections can all build them, except for the recons. All right, the casualty clearing station is probably one of the most prolific British emplacements. It probably gets built in almost every game, just like medic bunkers are often built in any games involving the Wehrmacht. It actually is a combination between a triage and a medic bunker, because it does not only send out medics to pick up wounded soldiers and bring them back to form free squads for you, but it has the ability to press this button here and spend 40 munitions to, within this large radius, heal all friendly infantry the way that a triage does. And it lasts for approximately 30 seconds here, so it's going to heal up everybody all the way, no problem. And that's a very cool multi-use building that gets built almost every time for the British, so definitely consider it if you aren't already. All right, let's talk about the mortar emplacement. The mortar emplacement can be used in two major ways, offensively or defensively. Defensively, you can put it sort of near or slightly to the side and behind of your headquarters command truck. And what it does is it's got a pretty long range, so you can use it to make sure that no enemy machine guns are locking you into your base. But the way that you can use it offensively is put it further out on the map to try and dominate map areas like victory points and important resources. However, that is a bit risky because it is a vulnerable emplacement, probably one of the more vulnerable emplacements. It actually takes a significant amount of damage to by small arms, like these MP40s, as well as grenades, like that. It also is extremely vulnerable to Panzer Shreks, just like all the other emplacements are extremely vulnerable to Panzer Shreks. But even just leaving these guys here, they're just going to murder the emplacement over time. It's going to take 30 seconds or less for them to shoot this emplacement to death, which is not something that you ever see happen to a bunker or an American machine gun emplacement, for example. The Vickers is just like one of those, but it also has the same weakness to small arms fire and extreme weakness to Panzer Shreks and grenades that the mortar emplacement does. So you do have to be careful about this, and you have to defend it. It can help defend you as long as you defend it. So the sappers can build three emplacements that are specific to them. The infantry sections cannot build these, so you can't get these until the second truck. The 17-pounder AT gun is very effective against enemy vehicles, and even though it looks like when you build it, it only has a single arc of fire, it can actually pivot within that emplacement. And unlike normal AT guns, it's more protected against infantry rushing at it. Then you have the 25-pounder howitzer, which is basically equivalent to the howitzer that the Americans get. You choose a spot and you blow stuff up, like, oh, I don't want that building to be there anymore. And then it says, okay, no, righto, chaps, we're going to make the building go away. We don't like it when you're upset, so we're going to make that happen for you, eh? And then the building goes away, and that's how that works. Now, the boffers. Rogers, tell us about the boffers.
The boffers is very effective against infantry, as well as you'll see it effective against light vehicles, too. It's a great structure because it can pivot around, so it can turn as infantry are trying to flank it, unlike a static MG emplacement. So it's good to use for overarching lines of defense. It's very good against light vehicles, like I said, and infantry are just getting shredded. So especially against multiple squads, I think it has a little bit of splash damage. So it's very useful. Very
and
good.
And it doesn't take the same kind of damage that the mortar did. Although you can see the 17-pounder is still kind of vulnerable to vehicles there. Oh man, look at those sandbags go flying. Good times, good times. So you're new to the game, you haven't played the British, you want to get some kind of idea. What should you do at the beginning of the game? So we're right here at the beginning of the game, and this is probably what you should be doing in the first 5 minutes. Take your first squad. Step one is take your first squad and send it to the point where you're going to establish your forward base. And you're always going to establish a forward base when the British. You don't leave your truck in the main HQ like I've seen a lot of new British players do. You always want to move that truck because it can OP a point for free and allow you to reinforce closer to the front line. So let's take these guys and send them over here to, let's say, this fuel point. Meanwhile, step two is you want to build a lieutenant from your HQ. The reason that you want to build a lieutenant is because of the three options here. Only the lieutenant and infantry section can help you cap points, which in the beginning is very important. And the infantry section is going to move very slowly outside of your own territory without the lieutenant. So the lieutenant is a great early choice to then go and help you cap the resources near your base. Alright, so now that we've got our lieutenant, we're going to pack up our HQ by click the mobile button. And once it's packed up, we're going to immediately send it to the point that we sent our infantry to capture. Now, if you make that point too far forward, you're going to be very vulnerable to enemies rushing in and destroying your HQ with Panzerschrecks or something else. But you usually want to make sure you're sitting on something that gives you a huge benefit, like this plus 16 fuel is going to be a huge benefit when we sit on top of it. So we're going to do that. We're going to put our HQ way the heck back here so it's as far away from the action as possible while still being set up within this plus 16. Meanwhile, we're going to send our recon section out here to cap more things, and our lieutenant is going to be sent over here to cap more stuff. And you can use your shift commands to click here, and then shift and click over here to give them queued up orders so they go and do multiple things. We tell our lieutenant to click here, and then we'll hold shift and click on this, and then he'll do them in those orders. All right, the last step, once you have your HQ set up in its newly secured location, is continue to cap the points around you and build whatever you would like, whatever works for you. Another infantry section would be a good choice if you want some extra firepower against enemy units. Another lieutenant is not usually a good choice because the stacking bonuses were changed, so it's not that useful anymore. A Bren can be a good early game unit. It can give you some additional destructive power against light vehicles. So if you're facing the Panzer Elite, a Bren carrier is a good choice. So you can kind of have your choice at this point and continue on the game, but that's a good first four steps that you should do. First, send your recon squad out to cap a point that you're going to set up your forward HQ at, then build a lieutenant, then once he's done, move your truck to the newly captured point, and then just cap with your lieutenant and recon until you can build more things out of your HQ. So that's what you should do at the beginning of a game. Alright, so the last section of the show today is going to be a couple tips and tricks on how to use the British that may not be readily apparent. So Rogers is going to tell us some tips that you can use with your Bren carrier if you choose to build one early in the game.
Alright guys, Bren carriers can be very useful. You can pop an early lieutenant in a Bren carrier and have it drive around for a little bit of mobile capping, which is really nice. It's like a little Kettengrad that can fire, or a little bike that can fire. It's very useful. You can also use it against snipers, because snipers are very dangerous, and you want to keep an eye on all your officers, because they can be two-shotted by a sniper. Two or three shots, I believe. So what you can do to counter that is you can have a recon section inside of a Bren carrier and run that up to the sniper and then pop the recon section out. And if he doesn't notice, you probably have a chance to snipe him. At very least, you'll retreat him. So that's a very good little trick there as well. Also, the Bren upgrade for the Bren carrier is very, very effective. It's very good against infantry. It can also use armor-piercing rounds against light vehicles, so it can counter those armored cars from the Panzer Elite or even the Wehrmacht Half-Track or the Puma. It's a very useful little light vehicle early game. Also, one more thing to mention is that it becomes very micro-intensive in the late game, at least it can be if you want to keep that thing alive, because just about anything can kill it. The Pumas can kill it, armored cars can kill it, infantry MP40s can kill it. So you want to keep a very close eye on that thing and always keep it kind of in the back lurking around. Use the armor piercing or the button ability. But use it more of as a support unit in the mid and late game, as opposed to in the early game when you use it more of as an offensive and harassing tool. But the Bren carrier is freaking awesome, guys. It's very useful. A lot of different abilities that you can use for it. It's just it's a very good early game unit. I would highly recommend it. Also, another thing that's a useful little tip here is trenches. You can build a trench about to the 95% mark, or however close you want it, and then build that near a home territory sector or your HQ or something like that. And then if they rush in, if they try a little half-track rush or whatever, you can retreat your guys, have them finish the trench, and hop in it. But in the meantime, like, all the Germans could do is they could blow up the trench. They can't hop in it because it's not completed. So that's also a little useful tip for people if you're afraid of getting hit at your base.
All right, the last tip that we want to share with you guys is very simple. Keep your officers alive. Keep them alive. I cannot stress that enough. The lieutenant at level 2 vet is very scary. Very, very scary to the opposing team. So you want to keep it alive, because it's also very expensive to replace, and you really do need it. Without that lieutenant, your guys are much, much weaker, and they're much, much slower. So keep your lieutenant alive. He's very vulnerable. He gets a little harder to kill over the course of the game, but it's up to you to keep him out of the line of fire. He's got a long range on his buffing. Just keep him way in the back. It takes two shots to snipe him, so you do have a chance to retreat him if he ever does get in trouble. And I think that just about covers it for tips and tricks in general for the Brits. That covers the early game. Let's end this, shall we say. All right, that about does it for the British overview here. I know Roger's got the best of me in every Training Tuesday so far, but I think I've got it this time. What do you got? You got an officer?
Oh,
yeah.
Don't worry.
Yeah, see this line that I've built? Oh, come on. They're going to be defended from they're going to be defended from artillery. That's why they're in trenches. That's why they have hull down.
Wow, it didn't come down? What?
Something's not right here. Whoa! Oh no!
Blitzkrieg!
Wait, they were already behind me. When did you do that?
I won't tell.
I'll never tell. Everybody, on the hull down! Defend the homeland! Move!
Tiger!
We can't even kill one squad! Run, Firefly! Run! It's your only hope!
Eat funnel grenades. Yeah! Oh!
Wait, there was a tiger waiting for the Firefly! Alright, then. So I've been defeated again. So that happened. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. And we'll see you again in 2 more weeks.